The largest collection of Mesolithic and Neolithic fishhooks in Europe comes from archaeological sites along the coasts of southern Norway and western Sweden. During the last decade, archaeological excavations and discoveries of singular stray finds have largely increased the corpus of bone fishhooks and bone debitage from fishhook manufacture. This has sparked new interest in questions concerning fishhook typology, technology, raw material use, and the social and symbolic importance of fishing. Our project has been dedicated to study how the fishhooks were accomplished. A further objective has been to address what the manufacture can reveal about the organization of everyday crafts in the prehistoric communities. Several studies have been undertaken on early and middle Mesolithic bone technologies in Europe. Investigations combining attribute analysis, use wear analysis, and experiments show that bone tools, which are similar in form, were fashioned in different ways. Regional traditions have also been noticed with reference to spatial utilization as well as production techniques. Experimental replication is a viable way to acquire hands-on knowledge of how the fishhooks were manufactured and the skills and time which was involved in the process. Since bones were worked with stone tools, actualistic experiments also give important insights into the relationship between stone and bone technologies during different periods of the Stone Age. So far, fishhook technologies have not been subject to intense experimental replication, as have many other categories of bone implements. Some experimental studies have focused on the manufacture and functionality of early and middle Mesolithic fishhooks. But the present study is the first in Norway to replicate late Mesolithic and Neolithic bone fishhooks. Making a bone tool follows a series of operational steps, and the aim of each experiment is to reconstruct these steps using actualistic stone tools. And building on observations of animal bones, bone debris, fishhooks, and hook preforms found at the archaeological sites. Our project has been focusing on the following research questions. Which tools and operational steps were involved? Can different operational chains be identified? And do they differ over time or between regions? Which animal species and bone elements were utilized? And which skills, knowledge, and experience is needed to accomplish them? Were fishhooks made by specialists, or was it common knowledge? For our experiments, we have used the lower leg or metapodial bone from European elk, red deer and roe deer, and ribs from red deer. Six individual hooks representing three distinct types have been replicated. Number 1 to 3 are barbless hooks with notches for fastening the line. The type is dated to the middle and late Mesolithic, and our replicas are based on finds from Viste and Skipsselen in western Norway. Number 4 and 5 appears with and without barb and have a small knob for line attachment. The type occurs during the late Mesolithic in eastern Norway and western Sweden. In western Norway, it appears a little later in the early Neolithic. Our replicas are based on finds from Rotkärsli in western Sweden. Number 6 is a barbed hook with an elongated knob and a curved shank. This type is dated to the middle Neolithic and our reconstruction is based on finds from Rørvik outside Gothenburg. The large hook number one was replicated using a metapodial bone of elk. First, we remove the skin by the use of a stone blade. The sinews are taken out and will be used for making the lines. The articular end is removed by a prepared blow, and then the bone needs to be split to make two bone blanks. We can do this by grooving with a flint blade, or we can use stone wedge and apply indirect percussion. Both techniques were used in the Mesolithic, representing two distinct technological traditions in Scandinavia. In Western Scandinavia, a lot of bone work was done using grinding techniques. With a grinding slab, we can remove excess bone and make a flat bone blank. And then we can shape the outer part and the bend of the fish hook. Using a flint drill, a hole is made at the distal end of the bone, and then the inner part of the hook is grooved out using the sharp edge of a thin blade. The hook is nicely polished, and then a new one can be made from the same blank. This results in a specific triangular piece of bone debitage, which we can recognize among the archaeological bone remains. The initial steps for two are the same as for number one, but using a CO suggested by Bergsvik and David, we can make four hooks out of one blank. We first shape the outer part by grinding, and then two opposite holes are drilled. Instead of grooving out a triangular piece, we remove the inner part of the hook by grooving between the holes. In this way, people made the most of their raw materials, and the procedure generates very small amounts of bone debris and a characteristic piece of debitage. Number three, to the right, have visible traces of drilling, and we assume that the barb-like protuberance is remnants of the production technique rather than a functional barb. This trait distinguishes this type from the vista type, where all the traces of a drilled hole have been removed during the last stages of production. The main difference between type 1, 2 and 3, there seems to be less effort invested in the final shaping of the hook. Number 3 is here replicated with a rib from red deer. The rib is thinner and much easier to shape, so with a little practice we were able to make such a hook in about 20 minutes. Since making hooks with using metapodial bones or other long bones takes hours, this discovery made us wonder essentially why all hooks weren't always made from ribs. Using a bow and drill, such hooks can be produced in large amounts. Debris and preforms from sites here from Rogaland, Western Norway, shows that several techniques have been applied. To the left is a long bone preform with a V-shaped cut, to the right, debitage with the inner part of the hook grooved out, and in the middle, a worked piece of rib. The questions of time and skill were issues we pondered while working on the barbed hooks. They appear in different sizes, and in this experiment we settled for red deer metapodials. No grinding tools or preforms with signs of drilling were observed at the site, but plenty of small drill bits and flint blades were recovered. This debris indicates a CO involving removal of the inner part of the hook by grooving, and we therefore proceeded with the grooving technique using flint. Shaping a blank in this way works well, but the blades quickly worn out, so a large amount of blades were used. Making the barb, and in particular the double barb, without drilling first is difficult and needs careful planning and patience. Making the bend and the barb without drilling require a lot of pressure, and the bone needs to be grooved from two sides. It's therefore most convenient to complete the barb and the knob while the hook is still attached to a handle. The procedure still took several hours. When the hook is detached, we remove the debris with a well-placed blow. And this piece of debitage also turns out strikingly similar to the archaeological bone debris. We have attempted to replicate number 6 using elk, red deer, roe deer and ribs, and failed most of the times, causing our expert much frustration. Why is it so difficult? Well, the main difference between this and the Mesolithic hooks is the curved shank. Grooving in a circular movement with the blade is a precision work that requires a high degree of skill and experience, and it results in the rounded piece of debitage. Archaeological preforms show that the bend was finalized by a transversal cut, then grinded and polished after detachment. And when we tried with ribs and roe deer metapodials, they all broke at the bend, which is a weak point of the bone fishhook. With a massive elk metapodial, it was almost impossible to penetrate the bone matrix. So we have not yet fully come to terms with how to accomplish these Neolithic fishhooks. In coastal Western Scandinavia, fashioning fishhooks from bone is a technological tradition of remarkable persistency, lasting for at least 6,000 years. The symbolic importance of fish and fishing is also underscored by rock art images. Bone fishhooks of various sizes can be made with a wide range of animal species and bone elements. And in the future research, more osseous material, as well as the functionality of different types of hooks, should be further tested. Different COs were identified, possibly related to variety in raw material availability, such as better access to flint at the sites in Western Sweden. The Mesolithic hooks are relatively easy to accomplish, but the manufacture process is very time-consuming when actualistic tools are utilized. However, even simple techniques take time to master, as demonstrated by some of these rather helpless initial attempts by the present author, seen to the right. Much time must have gone into grinding or scraping bone to make blanks and preforms. This rather tedious task could probably have been performed by anyone, even children. The barbless fishhooks were fashioned in the same way throughout millennia, and since the transmission of craft in small-scale communities is strongly socially mediated, these persisting technological traditions are indicative of vertical transmission of the technology. Age, though, presumably plays a role in handling bones, because fully grown elk bones are massive and require a certain strength and hand size. For the Middle Neolithic hook technology, the issue is more complex. Making barbed hooks with a rounded shaft require more skill and experience. This might indicate that the social organization of the craft was different, possibly indicating horizontal rather than vertical transmission. As with some of the lithic technologies in this period, the Middle Neolithic fishhook manufacture seems to have been more specialized. Considering the importance of fish in the diet, making fishhooks and other fishing implements must have been an important and constant maintenance task in these coastal communities. And since we must assume that many hooks were lost while fishing, considerable effort must have gone into this activity.